Meg, you can tell me to mind my own business if you like, but is everything all right between you and Bob?
Yes, of course. Why shouldn't it be?
Well, it's got nothing to do with me, but he did seem to leave rather quickly, that's all.
Look, I know you're not prying, and I appreciate your concern. But Bob agreed to go on that Indonesian trip on the spur of the moment. And he was committed. Well, he wanted me to go with him.
So why didn't you?
Well, can you imagine me sipping pink gins and playing bridge with all the other wives at the Colonial Club? No, it just wouldn't have worked. Anyway, it's only for 6 months. He'll be home soon, and then everything will be fine.
Yeah, that's what I thought when I went to Vietnam.
Look, Bob's a good man. He's better than I deserve.
Seeing that fucking charge down upon you. Where the hell did they get those keys from?
Perhaps they grabbed them off one of the other ones.
Police, please. Let's hope not. Yes, it's Wentworth Detention Center here. We've got a full-scale riot on our hands. No, they've got a set of keys. They've got complete run of the place.
Oh, right. Fire!
Their brothers are under reception. We'll try and hold them in the prison until you get here.
Look, Meg, this situation is likely to last for a few days. I'm going to have to call in some extra staff to relieve the officers guarding the front entrance. Do you feel up to a stint on duty?
I'd like to, Jim. I really would, but I just don't know whether I could trust myself. I mean, I wasn't much good the last time they tried to break out, was I?
Oh, come on. We all crack up at some stage or other. The pressure gets to all of us. You've always coped before. This is not the first riot you've been involved in.
When those women came charging at me, I was petrified. All I could think of was the time Bill was killed. All he ever did was help those women. You never knew him, did you?
No.
He's a good man. Too good to waste like that.
Ever since you vied with Colleen Powell for the promotion, you have been intent on fighting the system.
Rubbish! Of course I was disappointed when Colleen was promoted over me, but it hasn't affected my attitude in the least.
Hasn't it? Well, I think it has. In my position as governor, it is my job to keep an eye on the attitude of the staff.
Very well. I had hoped that we could use our friendship to work this dispute out rationally. But as you point out, you're the governor and I'm the union stirrer. Perhaps if you'd got to your position by patrolling corridors and breaking up catfights for years, you'd have my attitude too. Obviously, having a university degree gives you a greater insight into other people.
Meg!
I don't think there's anything more to say at this stage, do you?
You know, it's quite possible the women could lose interest very quickly. I've seen it happen before with nearly every project we've initiated.
Well, I just have to make sure that I get them really enthused. About the press, I mean.
I suppose you realise it'd be very foolish of you to get involved with any of the prisoners.
It's not any of the prisoners that I want to get involved with. It's one of the officers.
Yes. Look, I have to go. I hope I've been able to help you.
You're a real hit and run, aren't you? How about coming and having dinner with me later in the week?
Ian, I'm married.
Well, so am I. And separated. And so are you, aren't you?
But not in the same sense. My husband's just away on business.
Okay, but it still must get pretty lonely. You know, all I'm offering is just companionship. We can have some fun together, that's all.
I'm sorry, it's just not possible. I've enjoyed our conversation, but I have to go.
Well, what about if I come with you, just for a cup of coffee?
No. I'll see you at work.
Okay.
Who's there?
Surprise, surprise.
Oh!
It's a fabulous place, Meg. You can get domestic help for a song. I mean, you could have a house full of servants.
Could I? You know, I get the distinct impression that you want me to come back with you.
Well, of course I do. I want my wife with me. It's natural.
Your wife has a job of her own.
Well, you can give it up for the sake of our marriage.
Want to go and live a life of leisure in Jakarta.
What's wrong with that?
Well, what am I going to do? Sit around fanning myself all day? Or would we employ a servant to do that as well?
You don't have to have domestic help if you don't want it. You can do everything yourself. I don't care. I just want you to come back with me.
I feel so useless out there.
Well, you wouldn't be useless. You'd be giving me support. And that's what a wife is for.
In Jakarta, maybe. Do you want some more coffee?
No, Meg, I just want to hear you say you're going to come back with me.
Bob, just give me some time to think about it.
I didn't think it'd be so difficult for you to choose between your job and your marriage.
I see. Meg, it's come down to that, has it?
Sorry. I didn't mean to be so blunt. I guess I must be jet-lagged.
You should go to bed.
We should go to bed. Are you expecting visitors?
No.
Yes? Mrs. Morris?
Yes?
I'm sorry to bother you, but I was wondering if I could talk to you about a Judith Bryant.
Oh, go in.
Thank you.
Here we go again. Damn job of yours.
Sorry, darling, it won't take long.
I have a shower.
I must say, I'm glad to see you put in an application for deputy governor.
Yes, I'm wondering whether I should withdraw it now.
Because of Bob?
Mm-hmm.
Well, why don't you wait and see what happens? I must say, I think you have a good chance of getting the position.
Really?
Well, I'm certainly going to recommend you.
Well, thank you. Well, I'll have to talk things through with Bob over the next few days. Perhaps we can come to some sort of compromise.
Well, not mad, but a lot of fun. Well, come on, how about it?
No.
All right, forget about the oysters and stout. How about biscuits and cheese and a small sherry?
Bob, darling, what are you doing here? This is Ian Marnie, my husband, Bob Morris. Mr. Marnie's teaching the women how to use the new printing press.
Oh, nice to meet you.
Hi.
What are you doing here so early?
I thought you might like to go to lunch.
I'd love to go to lunch, darling, but you'll just have to wait a minute. I've got a few things to deliver to Mrs. Davidson's office.
I'll wait for you outside in the car.
Right.
Nice to meet you, Mr. Barney.
Marnie. Oh, look, by the way, if you are going to the Wentworth Arms, try the oysters. I believe they are wonderful.
Yeah, well, we'll see. Try not to be too long, darling.
I'm on my way.
Meg, Mrs. Morris. I'm sorry if I made it a bit awkward for you back there.
So you should be. God knows what Bob thought was going on.
Well, I didn't understand. I thought your husband was supposed to be in Jakarta.
Look, it really wouldn't make any difference if he was or not. Wherever he is, he's still my husband. And I don't make a point of accepting dates with other men.
Why not?
Look, I know this may sound old-fashioned to you, but that's the way I am. Darling, of course I want to be with you. But what is there up there for me? I mean, you'd be tied up with your business all day and I'd be stuck there with nothing to occupy me.
Well, there are all the other company wives up there.
Oh, yes, I've heard about that syndrome. No, thank you. Well, what about my career? It is important to me.
Career? A prison officer? Come on, Meg, you can do better than that.
Maybe I don't want to. I mean, people rely on me. I don't want to let them down.
Yeah, I know. We've been through all this before.
There's been another development.
What?
I'm in line for the position of deputy governor.
What?
Well, now that Jim's left, it's available. Looks like it's between me and Colleen Powell.
Well, she'll probably get it. She's a senior officer.
Not necessarily. I do have a chance.
Meg, what about our marriage, my job?
Well, what about our marriage and my job? Oh, really, I do have to go. We'll talk about it later tonight. Okay. What are you going to do this afternoon?
I'm going to Barnhurst to see Tracy.
For my love.
All right.
I know you are both very anxious, so I won't keep you in suspense. The board has just handed down its decision. The appointment of deputy governor goes to Mrs. Morris. Congratulations.
Oh. Well, thank you, Mrs. Davidson. I'm sorry, Colleen. You must be very disappointed.
No, of course not. Well, I am a little, but then that's the way it goes. Mrs. Powell, this in no way diminishes your value as a senior officer. You are a splendid asset to Wentworth, and I'm sure the board had great difficulty in making a decision.
Thank you, Mrs. Davidson.
Now, if you would excuse us, I have a few things to say to Mrs. Morris.
Of course. Congratulations, Meg.
Well, I must say I expected a little more enthusiasm.
I am pleased. Very pleased.
And Bob, how will he take it?
Well, you're rushing off home to tell your husband the good news, eh? I heard he was back in town.
There's nothing to tell him.
What? It's not every day you get a promotion.
I'm not taking it.
You're joking. Why not?
There are more important things, Joyce. Like keeping a marriage together. Bob wants me to go to Jakarta with him.
Well, I know it's none of my business, but I'm amazed. I never thought you'd leave the prison service, Meg.
Yes, well, that's what Mrs. Davidson said. It wasn't an easy decision.
Well, I hope that husband of yours realizes the sacrifice you're making for him.
Yes, I'm sure he will. Besides, it's not entirely for him. It's for me too, you know.
I'll phone through to the staff room and check if she's there. Who shall I say is calling?
Bob. I'm her husband.
Oh, is that right? I suppose there'll be a big celebration tonight, eh?
Celebration? Why?
Well, Mrs. Morris getting the deputy governor's position.
I didn't know it had been decided yet. When did it come through?
Only this afternoon. Oh, it's terrific for her, isn't it?
Yeah, it's terrific. Never mind. She's probably intending to stay back for a bit of a celebration with her friends. I'll catch up with her later.
Oh, I tell her you called.
You're running a bit late.
A few things to tidy up.
Excitement of the promotion worn off yet?
Even the need of the promotion has worn off.
Oh, your husband came by before.
What for?
Oh, I think he came by to pick you up.
Why didn't he stay? Well, why didn't you tell me?
Well, he told me not to bother, that you'd probably be celebrating with your friends.
Celebrating? How did he know?
Well, I happened to mention it.
I had 250 Bradley Street, Ivanhoe, please. The airport. That's international departures, and as soon as possible, please. Thanks.
To a more pleasant task. As you are probably aware, Mrs. Morris, due to personal reasons, was unable to accept the position of Deputy Governor. So I therefore have pleasure in announcing that Colleen Powell has been appointed, and I officially offer my congratulations. I'm sure she will do an excellent job.
Thank you. Congratulations, Colleen. Yes.
Well, that is all. The meeting is adjourned.
Well, your old man should be happy about that, Colleen.
Yes, I hope so.
I hope I haven't caused too many problems.
Not at all. You had a difficult decision to make. I hope everything is all right now.
Well, if you call getting a divorce all right.
Oh, Meg, I am sorry. Particularly as you'd given up your promotion.
Oh, I'd accepted that. When I rang you, I was absolutely sure I was making the right decision. But it was just Bob's attitude.
But when he realized that you'd given up...
Well, that's just it. He came here, heard about my promotion, and then just disappeared without even waiting to ask me about it.
I see.
When I got home, there was this note offering me congratulations. But no Bob. He'd already left the airport.
Well, perhaps if you ring and explain...
No, I couldn't do that. The point is, he just didn't give me a chance to talk about it. I couldn't even tell him that I'd made the decision not to take it.
Yes, it does seem very unfair.
Finally brought things to a head, though. It's made me realize there just isn't enough trust or understanding between us anymore.
There you go.
Thanks.
Just a bit of imagination. It could be anchored off some beautiful Pacific island.
Oh, my imagination's not that good. All I can smell is paint. At least I don't feel seasick.
Don't tell me you're not a good sailor.
I'm not sure. I haven't done much.
I was relying on you to be my first mate.
If we ever manage the same shifts off.
We have to wangle for a weekend off.
I can imagine what the staff will think of that.
Yeah? You reckon?
Oh, well, you know how people jump to conclusions.
Bah, who cares?
Oh, to be that young again.
Well, at least your husband's not bound to jump to the wrong conclusions.
No.
Sorry, Meg, that was a dumb thing to say.
It's all right. It has its compensations. I like living my own life.
Thanks for helping out today. I'm way ahead of schedule now.
It was fun.
And I meant what I said about coming out sailing.
Well, I'll be in it if I find I've got sea legs.
Here's to sea legs.
Sea legs.
What was your impression of Joan Ferguson?
Oh, well, she seems to know her job.
You have reservations?
No, it's... she's just a little masculine, I suppose.
Yes, I understand, Meg, but we mustn't let that concern us. Her private life is her own affair, as long as it remains private and doesn't conflict with her work.
Yes, I know. I'm sure she'll be very good.
If anyone tries to stop us, this lady will be copping a bullet.
Say he'll give you the word, Benny. Come on, Frank. Easy with that brush.
No one move.
Benny, come and get this big bitch.
Anything and I'll break her neck.
There you are. Plenty of milk and sugar. Just the thing for shock.
Thanks, but really, we ought to be going.
No, let them wait. You've had a nasty scare.
I'd have had a lot more if you hadn't been there.
Oh, just doing what I had to for a fellow officer.
I really am grateful. Though you had me worried for a minute.
Oh? Why?
Thought you really might break Hannah's neck.
Did you? Well, I'll go and collect her and we'll get going. No. You finish your tea.
Really, I'm all right.
Room all day, can I? I mean, what would you do,
Mrs. Morris? Someone's fiddling with my car. Hey! It's Margot Gaffney.
Too late, she's gone.
Oh, please don't, Mrs. Morris.
What do you mean? You were hiding her, weren't you?
No, I wasn't. She wanted me to, but I didn't, did I? I just gave her something to eat and some money and sent her on her way, or I was about to when you showed up.
But I can't let her get away with stealing my car.
Yeah, well, she's a dill, isn't she? She's going to dump the car sooner or later. Why do you have to involve the halfway house? Oh, please, Mrs. Morris. Look, it's not just for me, is it? I mean, I did what I did because I had to. She would have seen that no one came here. I mean, who'd stay here when it's run by a lager? Now, eventually, she's going to dump that car. With a bit of luck, the police won't even connect her with it. Please don't do this, Miss Morris.
But she's an escapee.
I know that. But if they connect her with me, after all the Maxine business, the department will close this place down in 2 seconds flat.
No, no. I have to tell them it was Margot. Look, I won't say that you knew she was here. I mean, they won't be able to prove anything as long as Margot says nothing when she gets caught. Trust me, Judy. I already told you that, Senior.
Oh, yes, that's right. So you did.
In fact, to be quite honest, I may have even left the keys in the car. I mean, I don't think I did, but I couldn't swear to it one way or the other.
Well, we've all done that at some time, Mrs. Morris. Forgetful beggars, aren't we?
I mean, you're the key witness. What are you going to do when you're sitting up there in that chair? Perjure yourself?
That's my worry. Not yours.
Yeah? Not from where I'm sitting, it's not.
Well, well. If it isn't little Meggie Morris, the prisoner's friend.
Enough, Gaffney. Don't bet on it.
Shut up, Margot. You keep out of this. It's between me and her.
I said that's enough. You're one of a kind, Gaffney. You know that? It's always somebody else's fault, isn't it? Never yours. Tell me. Who was it that made you break out of Barnhurst? Anyone we know? Who bullied you into going to the halfway house and stealing my car? I'd love to know who that was, because they've got a lot to answer for.
Very funny.
Shut up! Now, Bryant goes to court tomorrow. And if things go wrong for her, that's the finish of the halfway house and she ends up in here. Now, who do we blame for that, Gaffney?
You! You're the one that yelled copper.
Not soon enough.
Mrs. Morris, did Bryant give any indication that she knew of Gaffney's presence?
My answer could jeopardize the future of Driscoll House, which, in my opinion, is one of the finest projects the department has ever been involved in. I am not prepared to answer that question.
There's been enough time wasted already this morning.
In future, I'd advise prosecuting counsel not to waste the court's time with hostile witnesses. Mrs. Morris, you will answer the question or be charged with contempt of court. I'm quite sure you won't want to return to Wentworth Detention Center as an inmate.
Well, Mrs. Morris?
Looks like they're bringing someone in. Whew, must be a real tough to get all that attention. That bitch Morris. Trust her to get a ride to work with the cops. Why they got her by the arms? Maybe she's sick. Almost looks like they're bringing her in under arrest, don't it?
All right, Meg, now what's this all about?
I really had no choice, Mrs. Davidson. I couldn't see old Judy's good work go down the drain. And without my testimony, they had no option but to drop the charges. I realise I've disappointed you.
Nonsense, I admire your ethics. I just hope your faith in Judy Bryant has not been misplaced. I'm sorry you couldn't have been sent to Barnhurst, but the department cannot accommodate short-term prisoners there.
I'll survive it. It's only 72 hours after all.
Well, 3 days inside can be a lifetime. You ought to know that.
It need not be quite so grim. I'll have you placed in isolation. You need never see the women.
No, I don't want that. I don't want the women to think that I'm receiving any special treatment because I'm an officer. I mean, they'll resent it, and I'll lose their respect completely.
You can't be serious. Surely you realize you'll be in danger.
Yes, I do. But this is our chance to show the women that nobody gets special treatment.
I think Mrs. Morris is right. Technically, she is a prisoner and should be treated as such, but... Well, we have to show the women that we can take it as well as dish it out.
Well, I think you're wrong, but I shan't press the point. At least I can make sure you are in a single cell and there is always an officer on duty in the communal areas. I would prefer you not to work, though. I can't have Gaffney and her team locked up for 3 days. Is that a fair compromise?
I suppose so. But I don't want anything to jeopardize my position with the women once I'm back on duty.
I'm afraid the department has taken a very dim view of your contempt of court, regardless of your motives. There is to be a departmental inquiry to decide as to whether you may continue as an officer at Wentworth.
See? What did I tell you? Hey, Mrs. Morris. Is this for real, or are you on your way to a fancy dress party?
No, Bea, I'm in for real, as you put it.
Go on, straight up. What did you do? Put the hard word on Ted Douglas, did you?
I think that's more your line, Chrissy.
Good one, Mrs. M.
What did they get you for, then?
Well, let's just forget it, shall we?
Meaning you're not going to tell us?
Meaning it's my business, Chrissy. Same as any new prisoner.
That's right. If you don't want to tell us, that's fair enough by me, but you can't blame us for being surprised.
So, for the next 3 days, I'm just like the rest of you.
One of us, are you? That means you take your chances and fight your own battles and don't go lagging to the screws if something should happen to you, just like us.
I'm warning you, Margot, lay off. Time for your shower.
Yeah, it must be a bit of a lark, you being in here with us. Seeing how the other half lives, eh?
Well, it's hardly a lark, Chrissy, but it's educational.
Come on, Tammy, hurry up.
Good morning, ladies.
Morning, Mr. David.
Carry on, please. How are you getting on, Meg?
I'm fine.
You know, it would be quite in order for you to stay in your cell until the women have finished showering, Meg.
No, I'll wait my turn.
Very well, as you wish.
One of us, eh? Must be nice to have friends in high places. Once a screw, always a screw.
Shut your mouth.
Good one, Mrs. M.
Oh, yeah, off your tucker, Mrs. M.
So I'm afraid I am, Lizzie.
Tastes okay to me.
You and me have had a while to get used to it, Bea.
Well, like I said, the first 5 years
are the hardest.
Well, devil kidneys and the pheasant are off. So I had to put up with Mrs. O'Regan's revenge.
Yeah, well, look, never mind that now. We've got trouble with Gatlin again. She's drumming up recruits to do Mrs. M over.
Typical.
Well, you'd have been better off in isolation, Mrs. M.
I suppose so, Lizzie. I was offered it, but
You mean you could have set it out nice and cushy away from all of us?
Well, why the hell didn't you? I would have done.
Yeah, we know.
How could I possibly justify being treated any different from the rest of you? I mean, if there's going to be trouble, I have to face it the same way you would.
Oh, but you would have been safe, Mrs. M.
Don't worry, Lizzie. She will be.
If there was trouble, you'd be behind it.
Oh, that's bloody marvellous. Yeah, that is
so warm. Maggie, you all right?
I think so. I could have been worse if it hadn't been for Chrissy.
Latham? Well, then who's responsible?
I don't know. I didn't see them, and they're very careful not to say anything.
Okay, Latham. Who's responsible for this?
Beats me.
Never seen them before.
No, don't get smart. I want names.
Well, you'll have to get them from someone else, won't you? Because I don't lag.
Well, is that so? Okay, you can think about it in the pound.
Holly, no.
Stay out of this, Meg. I'm not going to sanction these women covering up for each other. Take her away.
Oh, thanks a million.
Oh, what a mess.
Yeah, and this is just the beginning. Now, come on, can't you see why you've got to go to isolation?
No, I don't see. It's more important than ever for me to stay right here. Otherwise, they just lose respect for us.
Gee, Mrs. Morris, you look terrible. What'd you do, walk into a glass door and get yourself all cut up? What a pity.
Piss off, Margot.
There's your culprit. Signed, sealed and delivered.
Let it go, Lee. You're probably right, but I don't think there's anything we can do about it. No?
Meg, have a word for you. Live along, Lee.
Is there something wrong?
Everything's wrong. You think you've got a friend in B. Smith, but you must know by now you can't trust any of these women. And look how they bashed you.
It had nothing to do with B.
I didn't say it did. It's not safe for you and with the other women if you'd only go to isolation.
Steve, I can't. Look, I'm doing this for principle. And I'm sorry you don't agree with me. Now, you said I was vulnerable. And you're right. If I hadn't have had that single cell, this attack would never have happened on me. Well, from now on, I'm not going to let that situation occur again. I'm going to work.
Work? Where?
Well, in the laundry, print shop, workshop, anywhere. There's safety in numbers. One thing has been made very clear to me, though. We've always suspected Joan Ferguson of dealing with the women. Now I'm sure of it.
Well, do you have any proof?
No, I haven't. But I've thought of the perfect plan to go about getting it. It involves playing Joan at her own game.
Meg, I know you're devoted to the women, but I hope you haven't picked up any of their rash ideas.
A corrupt officer is as much our concern as theirs.
More, I hope. And whilst I would prefer you to be proven wrong about Joan, it is vital that we know the truth.
Exactly. Now, if there was more than one other officer involved in the same corrupt practices, they'd inevitably be drawn into collusion.
And?
And if I appear to have been corrupted by my stay here with the women and pretend to be involved in gambling, protection and other such rackets, any other corrupt officer would be drawn straight to me.
No, not under any circumstances.
But Erica, you said yourself, we have got to know. Now, this way we can get proof one way or the other if Joan Ferguson really is as crooked as the women claim.
You have just spent a short term in prison on a matter of principle. No one who knows you, least of all a bent officer, is going to believe that you are corrupted.
But can't
you will have to come up with a much more credible scheme, Meg, before I could even consider it.
Morris, ex-prisoner.
Stand up straight when you speak to me, Gaffney.
Yes, sir, Mrs. Morris, sir.
Oh, you shut your mouth. I am sick to death of your antagonism.
So what?
Now, you keep away from Paddy Lawson. You could do that girl a lot of harm.
What you gonna do, come and beat me up in the cell?
One thing I did learn when I was in here as one of you.
You were never one of us.
That sometimes a heavy hand is necessary. Now you lay off me and you lay off Paddy. I haven't forgotten the little visit that you and your friends made me. Now, you get out of here before I lose my temper.
Stay. Well, the last person I expected to see.
Yes, well, things haven't been very pleasant lately. That's why I'm here.
Go on.
I know we've had our differences, but I just don't like working under those conditions, and I don't suppose you do either.
No.
So I'd like to apologize and hope that we can let bygones be bygones and start afresh.
Fair enough.
Good. Whew, I'm glad that's off my chest. Well, I do think we should get to know each other better, and so I was wondering if perhaps you and Colleen might like to come to my place for dinner tomorrow night.
Oh, I'm sorry, but
Olive, if you've got something else, perhaps we can make it another night.
Look, I appreciate what you're trying to do, but I don't think so.
Right, well, I better be going. I hope I haven't made you late for work.
Of course not.
Bye. I don't know why you don't go and get a job on a sheep station. You'd be just as happy herding animals.
That's what I'm doing now.
Believe it or not, those women are human beings with a lot more human feeling than you'll ever have.
Oh, come off it. Take off your rose-coloured glasses. How long have you been in this job? God, you know, you can't treat whores and thieves and murderers like a bunch of girls at a finishing school.
Sometimes the only difference between an officer and a prisoner is a conviction. I think you're on the wrong side of the bars, Joan.
Maybe. But you'll have your nervous breakdown long before I have mine. Smith's hearing's still on.
I know.
Interruption, Mrs. Morris.
I want to testify in Smith's defense.
I thought you said none of the officers had anything to add to this inquiry.
Mrs. Davidson doesn't know anything about this. I've only just decided to come forward myself. You see, I was a prisoner here for a while. I know how Officer Ferguson conducts herself when she thinks no one's looking.
I hear you testified against me.
Had your ear to the door, did you?
It's certainly nice to know what you think of solidarity between officers.
You had it coming.
I won't forget this.
You don't scare me. And if I were you, I wouldn't waste my time making threats. Why don't you resign before you're kicked out? What's going on, Colleen?
Well, Miss Ferguson here seems to think that you've been smuggling goods into the women.
And she wishes to conduct a body search on me. Is that correct?
Yes,
it is in the regulations.
What utter nonsense. Colleen, you can't seriously believe...
If you have nothing to hide, Mrs. Morris, your objection is pointless.
How dare you? How long is this farce going to continue?
It is in the regulations.
The regulations also state that there has to be sufficient reason for a body search. You've no proof to back up your accusations.
My experience as an officer
tells... That cuts both ways. My experience tells me that you're as suspect as I allegedly am, or Mrs. Powell, for that matter. So let's search you whilst we're at it, shall we?
Oh, come on, Meg. This isn't going to get us anywhere.
Quite the contrary. Rules are rules. I'll agree, providing we're both searched. Ferguson first.
Well?
Well,
I have nothing to hide. But this exercise is pointless, so I will withdraw my accusation for the time being. Forget it.
And I'll withdraw mine. But I certainly won't forget it.
If you can't stand the heat, stay out of the kitchen.
Subtlety's never been your strongest point.
No strength, yours, it seems. You're sort of weakened in the face of discipline. You've got no respect for it.
I'm sorry to have to disappoint you, but I've got plenty of strength. I won't back away from you.
Haven't you been doing just that lately?
To a degree, I suppose I have. But it won't last. And in the end, you can bet I'll be waving you goodbye.
Ferguson has filed a report with Ted Douglas about your slip-up with Barry Simmons.
Oh, no. I gather he wasn't too pleased.
He was furious. He... Well, there's no other way to say this. He feels that it would be in Wentworth's best interest if you were dismissed.
You can't be serious.
I argued with him on the strongest possible level. I told him how much I valued you as an officer, but, well, you know how dogmatic he can be when he wants to.
I know exactly what you mean. You needn't say any more. I've been thinking about this for quite some time. I think it'd be best if I resigned. I'll leave as soon as it's convenient.
Mrs. Morris, is it true what we hear? Are you going?
How did you know? Lizzie, you didn't.
Well, I can't help it if I've got extra sharp hearing.
Especially if her ear happens to be glued to the door.
But have you handed in your resignation?
Now, you know the regulations.
Yeah, off by heart. Have you resigned?
All right. Yes, I did.
There, you see.
But you can't.
There's no way no one will let you go. You know that, don't you?
I appreciate your concern, but you are out of line. It's my business, and it's done now.
Well, it will have to be undone.
Oh, Meg, sit down. I have just had a discussion with Ted Douglas about the strike. Needless to say, he's jumping up and down about it.
I can imagine.
I'm afraid we're not on very friendly terms after our discussion.
Why?
Well, I told him that I agreed with the women, that you should stay.
But that's not possible. I mean, if I withdrew my resignation, he'd sack me anyway.
No, no, I talked him out of that.
Well, I just don't know whether I want to stay. I can't seem to work under the present circumstances.
Well, I realize the no communication rule has never worked, but I thought it was worth a try. However, as it's caused more trouble than it's worth, I'm prepared to drop it.
What about censorship of the mail? I mean, searching the visitors?
Oh, well, that will have to stay for the time being. I have to tighten up somewhere, but... Once the women start to behave, then perhaps we can relax a little.
Well, I can understand that, but I'm just not sure I can abide by it, that's all.
Oh, now, Meg, I need you, and so does Wentworth. You've seen how the women reacted. You can't leave them like that.
Well, if I do stay, what happens to Ferguson?
Well, Mr. Douglas is convinced that the complaints against her due to... staff personality clashes. He sees no reason why she should be removed or transferred.
The women won't accept it.
Well, we've accepted their terms. They'll have to accept ours.
Until next time.
Oh, Colleen, I'm off to see Carter's father and then home to greet Marty.
Well, cheer up. It's your son, you see.
Yes, that's what worries me. It's just that I haven't had to be a mother for so long. I've almost forgotten how to begin.
Oh, come on, Meg. He's 19 years old. He'd probably appreciate it if you just try to be a friend.
I suppose so.
I don't often take my own advice, but listen to me. You always want to mother them, no matter what their age. Just enjoy having him home for the night, okay?